And now I can introduce the new, the second speaker of tonight, and this is Christopher Smart from STAR, Student Action for Refugees. And he's also the National Union of Students of the United Kingdom's Equal Access Campaign, and which promotes and improves access to higher education for people seeking refuge in the UK. Christopher also coordinates and shares best practice across 62 scholarship programs and works with a variety of other NGOs involved in the sector. At the university, Christopher set up one of these programs through student funding alone and continues to administrate this program in his spare time. As well as working for STAR, Christopher is also undertaking a master's at SOAS, at the University of London, in Migration, Mobility and Development. So, welcome, Christopher.
Thanks. Thanks so much for having me. It's lovely to be here in Leicester. So basically, yeah, just to clarify, I'd actually work for the NUS. The campaign I coordinate is in partnership with the NUS. I'm STAR's Access to University Coordinator, so that's Student Action for Refugees. And we're a national network charity set up in 1994. We've got about 50 groups around the UK. And basically, we try and make university culture more welcoming to refugees and create a generation of students who are outwardly kind of welcoming to refugees and kind of make that much more widely understood in society. So our students volunteer at projects like English conversation classes, homework clubs, even a refugee football team. They educate on campus, holding speaker events quite similar to this one, documentary screenings, panel discussions as well, and they also campaign on refugee issues. And as students, they're very able to mobilise support in quite a special way, especially being customers as well. Quite a lot can be changed by student activism. So that's kind of what the charity does more broadly. My role is to coordinate our longest running campaign, which is the NUS and STAR Equal Access Campaign. And that's in partnership with lots of NGOs to try and promote scholarships for refugees and asylum seekers to get to university. So I'm going to talk firstly about access to higher education for people seeking refuge. This has obviously been covered a little bit, so I won't kind of spend too much time on that. And then I'm going to speak about the current system of provision and kind of how it's developing, what needs to continue with this. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about why financial support isn't enough and why we need to do much more to extend this kind of culture of welcome beyond just scholarships, but a much more kind of holistic approach as well. So if you can't hear me, please do wave as well. So at present, access to higher education for people seeking refuge is a really complex issue, which is not given enough attention at all. It's a devolved matter with different policies in England, Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland, and those policies are kind of arranged in a similar way, in the sense that they're better in Wales and Scotland than England, which is a pretty common factor really. So the main issue which STAR's Equal Access Campaign focuses on is the barriers to study faced by people seeking asylum who do not have refugee status. So despite these individuals having fled their home, having fled persecution, despite our obligations under the 1951 UN Refugee Convention, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, Article 26, as you mentioned earlier, those seeking asylum and those granted the status of discretionary leave to remain and also humanitarian protection are classed as international students, which means they must pay higher fees, they cannot access student finance to cover their costs. And for asylum seekers, they don't even have access to work to even begin to consider funding international fees, which of course are even more expensive than the current rate of £9,250 a year in the UK for home students. So while in practice the law does allow these individuals to attend higher education, the nature of this policy amounts to a barring in practice of all but those people seeking asylum with funds to pay their own way. And this is a betrayal of our obligations to people fleeing persecution and othering and excluding of the most vulnerable in our society, and an incredibly short-sighted interpretation of the power of education to transform lives and become a force for change. These are not international students. They're not people who've chosen to come and study here. They've come here not voluntarily, but because of persecution and being denied access to higher education. That equal access, which is expressed in the UN Declaration of Human Rights, not only attacks these individual statuses as people, but it follows a kind of guilty until proven otherwise attitude that is so common in the hostile environment. In addition, it denies the universities of able and engaged students. It's a really common misconception that people seeking refuge are not able or willing to study. So in fact, in the scholarship program that I set up previously, in the 3 years we ran, over the last 3 years, almost every single applicant we had shortlisted actually had an undergraduate degree already. Often refugees are very well educated people, and it is a misconception that they wouldn't study, but it's a common one, and one that we have to kind of combat. University is a place that everyone starts fresh, and that's why it's so crucial that people seeking refuge can have access to university, because what better place to start a new life, to integrate, than somewhere where everyone is starting fresh. Everyone is new to university, everyone comes in to learn and to kind of develop. And so it's a really crucial part of that integration process, and one we need to kind of open up as much as possible. So that's kind of the broad overview of where things are. And thankfully, at the moment, a very inspiring movement of support has developed to combat this policy failure. So students, NGOs, universities, refugee campaigners, and others, for 10 years, have now been creating scholarships and bursaries to give higher education to people seeking refuge. So this is a really broad group of organisations which work together, and their student networks, scholarships, places of welcome for refugees, organisations like STAR, City of Sanctuary, which Colleen, if she will, I'm sure, tell you more about, or I'm sure you might already know, RefuAid, Article 26, Refugee Support Network, to name a few. It's a very big movement, and it's a really fantastic thing to be part of. So at present, there are 62 universities in the UK which offer some form of scholarship provision. And almost half of the universities in the UK that are involved, which is really fantastic. We're kind of getting to this point of critical mass within this campaign, and it's a really exciting time to be involved. We can't kind of let the momentum slide now as kind of refugee issues move out of the press focus. We have to kind of keep pushing forward. So a few months back, I attempted to work out the total value of the provision that's given, so the total funds committed each year by universities. And I must admit, I'm not a maths graduate, so. But I think that it's between seven and £8.5 million per year that are committed in value. So that's in terms of the kind of committed costs of a degree if it was a home student degree given by universities. And that's for around 180 to 200 places. It's not certain because not all universities say how many they give, and not all places are taken up, so they're very much estimates. But it just shows the generosity that is involved in this kind of process, and it's a really exciting thing to be involved in. So that's kind of where we currently are. And kind of what I'm going to kind of go on to is that this financial support is fantastic, and we hope that more and more comes. But as well as financial support, an increasing area of development is ensuring a much broader provision of support and training and welcome that extends beyond just simply funding someone to get to university. It has to kind of be something that continues into university, so people feel that they have a point of contact, people feel that they are students, rather than kind of just people who are, you know, special scholars isolated from everybody else. It's that engagement of a culture of welcome, which Cities of Sanctuary do so well, and we're really pleased to be working with them really closely as well. So an area which does this is the develop access and pre-sessional courses, and this is increasingly part of the work that is developing. And so foundation years, pre-sessional courses which might help with application to university, they might help with employment skills, these sort of things, understanding UK academic culture, where to apply for funding, where to seek support. These are really, really important processes, and it's that kind of getting people onto a ramp that extends into university and beyond, so that they have the skills to then once leave university to become part of UK society. So yeah, that's a really, really important thing. And a few weeks back, I was lucky enough to teach on one of these courses at the University of East London, explaining the kind of variety of scholarships available. And it's a really fantastic thing, and so I think that's something I would really encourage people to get involved in if you can, if there are groups in Leicester that do that, in pre-sessional courses. I'm sure we might hear more about that from the other panellists. But this is an increasing area, one that we're really pleased to see developing. Another element of this kind of comprehensive package of support is the provision of language support. So we've heard a little bit about language support, and it can be quite mixed. It depends what FU colleges give that provision. It's not universally kind of done at the same level, and so often asylum seekers who are in different areas have different qualities of language support. And so what we're increasingly seeing and encouraging is universities to actually offer ESOL provision themselves, and also a charity called RefuAid, which does a huge amount of work in giving places on language schools to make sure that people have the right qualifications to get into university and can actually study there effectively. So in addition to those kind of developments, and this really is stepping on kind of more what Colleen would be talking about, in the sense of extending a culture of welcome. And I know University of Sanctuary Leicester are here, and that's something that they'll talk about more, so I won't kind of go too much on that. But essentially, what's really exciting at the moment is that people are starting to think, okay, we've got these scholarships, we've got this kind of initial support, but how can we actually engage the community in that? How can we make people more aware of what's going on? How can we make kind of communities more open and kind of interested in what's going on and how we can improve people's lives as a result of that. And so as well as University of Sanctuary, which are doing fantastic work, STAR students are also kind of doing this at universities. We're starting to do open days. So we've got one coming up on Friday in Birmingham, where we'll get asylum seekers and people from a local refugee support group to come in, get into the university, in fact, just getting people inside university so they feel that they can apply, they've been inside, they've seen it, they understand what it's like to go in, to be welcomed. Getting people through those doors is such a crucial part of that process. So we're trying to get people in, explain to them with our students how to apply through UCAS, and using this kind of peer-to-peer support with other students as well, which is a really exciting program. So yeah, this kind of broader culture support is something which I really encourage. So that's kind of most of what I've got to say. I'm sure lots more will come in with questions. But I kind of want to finish with saying what's always kind of really surprised me about this work since I first got involved is how undersold and undervalued it is. Not simply for kind of press value for universities, but it's such a success story in a time when much of the news about refugees and refugee support is not positive. And here we have a really huge movement of generosity, of kind of problem solving, of grassroots support, helping people seeking refuge in the UK to access higher education and to rebuild and continue their lives, despite being failed resolutely by government policy. So as an action from today, if you like, it's a bit campaign speak, but I hope you won't mind, I encourage everyone here to go away and kind of talk about this. You know, what you hear today from the panel is really exciting. It's really a really good movement that's doing a lot of good work in the UK, on your doorstep, for people who are here. And so if you do anything for today, go away and tell people what's going on. You know, explain what's happening at Leicester, University of Sanctuary. Leicester's fantastic. There's all these kind of things going on, you know, after 18 of their work. Go away and talk about it, because I think not enough people know what's going on. Not enough people know there are problems, and even fewer people know that people are solving them. So it's not by any means finished, this work, but we're going a really long way to do that. So yeah, thanks so much for coming.